Good morning, First Baptist Church Aztec. I'm Jarrell, and I'm so glad you decided to spend your Sunday with us. We're so excited for worship and to dive into some powerful teaching. If you're a guest with us today, know that we're so glad to see you here. After service, Pastor Will would like to meet with you in the First Cafe area. You will also receive your favorite soda and candy bar. If you're looking for a church home, you've found a great place. Before we get started, here's a look at some of the things happening at First Baptist. Sunday, December the 13th at 5 p.m., we will have our children's Christmas program. Join Scotty and Faith as they wander into their local cell phone store and learn what the 5 G's of Christmas are really about. The next man's breakfast fellowship is Saturday, December 19th at 7:30 a.m. Men in the ninth grade or higher are welcome to come on their own, and those younger can come with their dad. We look forward to seeing you. December 20th at 4:30 p.m. or at 6 p.m., please join us for a special evening service as we celebrate Christmas with worship and the taking of the Lord's Supper. We still have the food pantry available if you or someone you know needs food during these difficult times. Please come down to the church and pick up a box of food. The bulletin is available through the YouVersion Bible app on your phone. Download the Bible app from your app store, and once signed in, select More at the bottom, then select Events. There you will see the bulletin for your church. Thanks again for being here today. Make sure to stay connected with us throughout the week online at firstaztec.org and on social media. We believe God has something to say to you, and our hope is that you will feel His love stronger than ever before. You picked a great day to be here, and welcome home.
Father God, we just come together here today to praise You, to worship You, to just sing about Your birth and what it does for us, Lord. As we start, Lord, we just pray that this worship would be honorable to You, that everything we do today, everything that we say, everything we do, will bring honor and glory to You. Be with our pastor as he's at home recovering. Watch over and protect him. Help him heal. Be with Will and help him have the words that You want him to speak. In Jesus' name, amen.
So everybody stand up, turn around, and Daniel's going to get a zoom by of the camera. We're going to all wave at Pastor Mike. So, we miss you, Pastor.
We miss you, Pastor.
He's doing the Zoom. Wait till he gets to you, then wave. You were disappointed there was no coffee, Brian? Oh. Somebody did not get the coffee.
Yeah, the little Pastor Mike.
He makes the coffee.
Thank you.
There should be something about us that we have an unspeakable joy. Amen?
Yes.
No matter what the season, it's because of the one who lives inside of us. And this next song that we're going to do, I know that you guys, how many of you know We Three Kings of Orient are? Okay, so how many of you know about the gifts that were brought to the Savior? But you know what? There's some that may not really understand the significance of the gifts. They didn't come without intentionality. They came bringing specific things, and I found this beautiful thing. Can I steal a minute of your thunder this morning, Will? I found this beautiful thing that Adrian Rogers had written, and he kind of breaks it down. He said, gold was brought for his sovereign dominion. Gold is a gift that would be presented to a king because it was the most precious metal of that day, and it symbolized royalty. The wise men recognized that this baby born in a manger was no ordinary baby. This was King Jesus. The wise men did not cuddle him. They did not play games with him. What did they do? They bowed down and worshiped before him, didn't they? Frankincense for his sinless deity. If gold was a gift of wealth for a king, then frankincense was used to worship the king. These wise men recognized the sinless deity of Jesus that was deserving of their worship. You see, Jesus was not only born a king, he was God in human flesh. Now, whether the wise men fully understood all of this or not, I don't know. But I do know that the Holy Spirit impelled them to make these gifts, and the Holy Spirit recorded these gifts. And last was a gift of myrrh. It says myrrh, his sacrificial death. The third gift the wise men brought was a valuable gum-like substance called myrrh that was used to embalm the dead. Can you imagine bringing a gift of myrrh to a newborn baby? They did this because they recognized that this little baby was born to die. Do you remember what Nicodemus brought? When Nicodemus came to prepare his body, Nicodemus also brought myrrh. It's recorded in John chapter 19. So what will you give this Christmas? Your wealth? He already owns everything that we own and beyond, right? What about your worship? Will you fall on your face before him this morning, maybe? Maybe not this morning, maybe at home during this time, this Christmas season. But what about your witness? Do you want the world to know that Jesus came to bring life, to bring it abundantly for us, and to bring it for eternity for us? Amen? Our wealth, our worship, our witness, it all belongs to him. Let's sing We Three Kings.
We Three Kings of Orient are bearing gifts. We traverse afar, hill and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. Oh, star.
Father, we thank you this morning. You could have come in any way that you wanted. You could have been born in a kingdom, in a palace. But Father, you came to the humble and you came to the lowly. You used shepherds, you used angels, you used men from afar. And a shepherd man, or a carpenter, Joseph, to be the earthly father. And a young woman to be your earthly mother. What a beautiful story. Thank you, God, for allowing us to be part of singing that story this morning as we continue with Noel this morning. Lord, I pray it just bring you glory and honor.
To babe on bended.
That was amazing. That was beautiful. Thank you. He is the light of the world. And we have an opportunity to speak that truth this season. Would you turn with me to the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter? Thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for joining us online and Facebook. Thank you for allowing me to open God's Word with you today. Can I tell you guys something? I love my new job. That's not always been the case with the different jobs I've had. I've worked in the oil field. I've worked for the Forest Service. I've been a cowboy, a concrete hand, an electrician, a man of many hats. But I've always had the fortune to meet a lot of different people in these different walks of life with different backgrounds, different ethnicities from different countries. I've always enjoyed discovering the things that I have in common with the people that I meet. And today, we'll look at a need that we all hold in common, from rich to poor, the strong to the weak, young and old, healthy or sick, no matter what race, no matter how good or bad you've been. We all have some very basic yet extremely important needs in common. Please allow me to pray. Join me in that. God, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. God, as we read your word, I pray that it fuels the fire within us. God, that your word would ignite old flames. God, that your word would ignite new flames. Thank you for your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So here in the Gospel of John, chapter 3, we're going to read a story about a man named Nicodemus. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. And what we're really speaking about here is somebody that is a leader in his church. Somebody who is leading the Jews spiritually, because regardless of the government the Jews had in front of them, it was their religious leadership that they followed. That's the significance of this person. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come to God, for no one could perform the signs you were doing if God were not with him." And he's acknowledging something that the rest of the Pharisees or Sanhedrin are not willing to acknowledge at this point. In fact, there are others in his group that are contemplating how to get rid of Jesus at this point. And so we see him sneak to him, to Jesus at night, and Jesus replies, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." He gets right to the point of the matter with Nicodemus. Nicodemus responds, "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asks, "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." And Jesus responds, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you should be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." We get a sense that Jesus is being a little short with Nicodemus. He doesn't even get to ask a question before Jesus tells him, "Listen, everything you've done at this point doesn't matter. You are not going to see the kingdom of God unless you're born again." And I think it might come from the fact that the Pharisees have been a stumbling block or a hindrance in his ministry up to this point, and continuing on in his ministry from this point forward, it's the Pharisees and Sanhedrin that are out to get Jesus. Nicodemus says, "How can this be?" And Jesus responds, "You are Israel's teacher." You get the sense that he's being a little short with Nicodemus again. He's saying, "You're their teacher? And you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify of what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that anyone who believes may have eternal life in him." Can you think of somebody that you have struggled to share the gospel with? Why do we struggle to share something that is so important to us? If we struggle, we need to ask ourselves why, or even what is the gospel? See, it doesn't matter what your condition, what condition your condition is in. We all need to know about the gospel, and we all have a responsibility to share it. We all need to share the gospel, and it is tough to share what you do not know. Even those at the top, like Nicodemus, know they need something more than all they have gained or achieved. They may not realize it is Jesus they need. Think of the wise men who were searching for Jesus. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 2. Now, I chose not to mark my passages so I would take time to find them and hopefully allow you time to find them as well. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews?" See, we can see wise men searching for Jesus. They traveled a distance. Little is known about these men. They're called kings of the Orient, we just sang about. And that's not really evident in our word whether they were kings or not, but we can tell they were affluent. They were able to travel and bring these gifts to Jesus. If you would turn with me to Luke chapter 2. Verses 8 through 14. We'll read about the story of the angels visiting the shepherds during Jesus' birth. I would encourage you to read the story of the birth of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke. I think it's covers it best, in my opinion. I love how Luke tells the story. And it is a great opportunity during this season to read that story in your home, perhaps in front of your Christmas tree. An angel of the Lord, we're in Luke 2, starting in verse 8. "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Let's pay attention to verse 10. But an angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring to you the good news that will cause great joy for all the people." So we can tell the message they were giving was not just for themselves. It was for all the people. A message that they should take forward and proclaim. Just as the angels had brought them that message, it was on to them to take that message into their community. Jesus' birth was first proclaimed to the shepherds, and they were told of the good news that will cause great joy for all the people in verse 10. Can you see the connection where we have people of an affluent background searching for the news for Jesus, and then we have people that are considered probably a more lowly standing, the shepherds. It's not the same shepherds as the time of Moses. Time has progressed where at this point in history, shepherds are not of status. In fact, they're viewed upon as heathens, if you will, or people that are outside of society, hill people, maybe. They still have a significant role in their culture, but there's a difference between them and the wise men. And we can see where some people have the good news and some are searching for it. Turn back to John chapter 3 with me. In verse 1, we see a man of the Pharisees, a ruler of the Jews, and not just any Pharisee. In verse 10, we can see Jesus asks him, "You are Israel's teacher?" He is a very high-standing Pharisee. He is at the top of his pile, if you will. Someone who should have been able to recognize Jesus for who and what he was. And maybe that's why Jesus was so short with Nicodemus, somebody that should have known his word, that studied the Bible, that read the things on the Sabbath that should have pointed to Jesus. So here we have a Pharisee living at the top of the heap. He had religion, status, wealth, a need for understanding. We can see him go to Jesus at night, and a need for Jesus. And like the Magi, he was searching for the truth. He had a chance to hear the truth. And it makes us wonder, did it make any difference in Nicodemus? You know, when people get past the fear of searching for the gospel, like Nicodemus, we need to get past the fear of sharing the gospel. You know, it's interesting why there is so much fear surrounding the birth of a baby. So much fear surrounding Jesus. And if you continue to read the story about the wise men in Matthew 2, we can see the fear that a king, King Herod, had over the baby Jesus. A fear that would cause him to do horrible things to his people. A fear that would cause him to try and kill an innocent baby. We can see fear in the hearts of men in verse 3 in the Gospel of John, where Jesus replies to Nicodemus, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Nicodemus doesn't even get to ask a question to Jesus before Jesus presents the answer, answering the question that is in Nicodemus's heart. That he's worried he's missed something. Here's a leader of the Jews. He's leading them in their religion. But he knows that he's seen God at work in Jesus' life and ministry. And he's worried. He has fear that there is something he has missed. In Luke 2, 9 through 10, we can see where we read where the shepherds were terrified and told not to be afraid. In Luke, the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth is there. And Zechariah in Luke 1, 13 is told, do not be afraid. Again, Mary is met by an angel and told, do not be afraid in verse 30. From Jesus' coming to his going, we will find fear in the hearts of men. Nicodemus had fear in his heart. He came to Jesus by night. The story says, he came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God. And see, that fear that he has of now being acknowledged with Jesus, associated with Jesus, it's caused him to sneak there in the middle of the night because he doesn't want to be associated with Jesus yet. He just wants to figure out if this Jesus thing has anything to it or not. Is it has any substance? But he doesn't want to be associated with Jesus just yet. Jesus tells his, Jesus knew Nicodemus' heart had fear in it. But Nicodemus came to Jesus because he wanted to understand what this all meant. In verse 4 and 9, you can see him ask the question, how can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked, surely they cannot be entered a second time into their mother's womb. He's giving a little pushback to Jesus right there. And he asks again in verse 9, how can this be? Nicodemus asked. So we can see and get a sense that Nicodemus truly wants to understand what he has missed in the life of Jesus. And it's often in those moments of fear that the heart is most open to the gospel. It's in those moments of fear where we can speak truth into someone's life. It's in those moments of fear that we're ready to listen. They bring us to a place of searching for the gospel. Jesus said, fear not and take courage. He told his disciples that over and over in Matthew 14, verse 27. He tells his disciples to fear not, to take courage. Because he knew the hearts of men, that we had fear. In Luke 12, 32, Jesus tells his disciples, do not be afraid. In the book of Revelations, Revelation 1, 17, in John's vision, Christ tells him, do not be afraid. Even in our visions, even in our sleep, we have fear. And Jesus comes to us and tells us, do not be afraid. Jesus replaces fear. He replaced Nicodemus' fear with the knowledge of the gospel. Fear can be removed with the knowledge of Jesus. And why is it sometimes that fear is the first thing we feel or experience when it comes to sharing the gospel? If you've thought about sharing the gospel with a coworker or how to share it again with a family member, there's fear, something that is a hindrance in our delivery. It reminds me of a story I heard on Christian radio. I can't remember the individual, but I tuned in the middle of his testimony. He was a fighter pilot who flew multiple missions over Kosovo. And he described an air-to-air encounter that he had. Ground-to-air fire was prevalent. They had to dodge a lot of Russian missiles. And each time he went forward, he admitted there was great fear. He said he had fear getting in that airplane and flying to what might be a certain death. He said fear is not absence, or courage is not absence of fear. It's having the ability to move forward when you are afraid that gives you courage. What really stuck out to me in his testimony was, he said all of those flights, all of the missions that he took, paled in comparison to sharing the gospel. That really stuck out to me. Somebody that on that level is willing to put their life on the line, on that level has faced fear so many times. His testimony was the most fearful thing that he had ever done was share the gospel. His testimony, a personal story about a relationship with Jesus. And that struck me as odd. If I self-reflect, I would have to join him in that. I can think of good relationships I've had with people and a closeness. Yet I had fear in sharing the most important thing about me with them. Where does that come from? Probably our enemy. Maybe it's because I didn't, or we don't fully understand the gospel. We don't fully understand what we're attempting to share. I know me, early in life, I believed in Christ, and that was enough. I didn't need to fully understand everything. I couldn't fully understand the Trinity. It's complicated. I couldn't fully understand why God would come to earth and die for us. But I believed that he did, and that was enough. But to go share what I believed might need a little more attention. And so we need to know and understand what the gospel is in order to share it without fear. It is the knowledge and understanding of the gospel that replaces fear in this life. Turn with me to Hebrews 2. Luckily, I do have tabs in my Bible, so I'm not totally lost. Hebrews 2, verse 15 says, "And free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death." He's speaking of Jesus coming and what he accomplishes in freeing those, and that's us, who in all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. It describes how Jesus sets us free from that fear of death. Jesus explains to Nicodemus, if you'll turn back with me to John 3. Jesus explains to Nicodemus how to replace the fear with hope. In verse 14 and 15, Jesus says, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him." And it is just that simple. It is something that simple to share with people, that if you believe, you will have eternal life. And I love the example Jesus uses, because here a man of the Pharisees knows this story and should recognize the significance of the snake in the wilderness. Is something we all share, is when that snake entered the Garden of Eden and bit first man and woman with sin. We have all been bitten. We have all been poisoned with sin. And it's our need for forgiveness. As Moses raised that snake up, and the Israelites who had been bitten by a serpent, if they would just look on it and believe they were healed, they were healed. And it is the same with Christ lifted up on the cross. If we will look to Him and believe that He died there on that cross, risen again for our sins, we will have eternal life. It's that simple. So Jesus explained to Nicodemus how to replace his fear. And the gospel is who Jesus was, what He said, and what He did. And who He was and what He did matters to each one of us, and how we choose to react to that knowledge. People can't react to Him unless they know of Him. And somebody told each one of us, helped each one of us become aware of Jesus. For me, it was a Sunday school teacher teaching a great Sunday school lesson to a child, allowed me to know who Jesus was, the things that He did and the things that He said, and how that mattered to me in my eternity. So if somebody has shared that with you, who have you shared that with? Have you owned that responsibility? Let's take a look at how Luke explains the gospel in the book of Acts. Turn with me to Acts 13. We'll look at verse 26 through 41. The point I'm making here is that all through our gospels are great examples of how and where we can turn to share the gospel. In the book of Acts, chapter 13, starting in verse 26. And I like these verses when I can read into it and I'm included in them. Because here it says, "Fellow children of Abraham and you God-fearing Gentiles." I think of God-fearing Gentile as probably my category. "It is to us that this message of salvation has been sent. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus. Yet in condemning Him, they fulfilled the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. Though they found no proper ground for the death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. When they had carried out all that was written about Him, they took Him down from the cross and laid Him in a tomb. But God raised Him from the dead, and for many days He was seen by those who had traveled with Him from Galilee to Jerusalem. They are now His witnesses to our people. We tell you the good news, what God promised our ancestors. He has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising up Jesus, as is written in the second Psalm. You are my son. Today I have become your father. God raised Him from the dead so that He will forever be subject, never be subject to decay. As God has said, I will give you the holy and sure blessings promised to David. I will give you the holy and sure blessings promised to David. So it is also stated elsewhere, you will not let your Holy One see decay. Now when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep and he was buried with his ancestors and his body decayed. But the one whom God raised from the dead did not see decay. Therefore, my friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Through Him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin. A justification you were not able to to obtain under the law of Moses. Take care that what the prophets have said does not happen to you. They said, "Look, you scoffers, wonder and perish, for I am going to do something in your days that you would never believe, even if someone told you." There's a lot said in those passages. Most significant is 39. Through him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin. A justification that we were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. Only Christ could do this for us. I like how John simplifies all of his writings. If you'll turn with me to John 20. John 20, he states the purpose of his gospel. In verses 30 through 31, he says, "Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are recorded in this book. But these are written," he says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. "But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." And that's pretty simple. By believing, we will have life in his name. And through his word, all throughout the Gospels, we can see the evidence of prophecy fulfilled. We can flip back to Isaiah and so many other books in our Old Testament and see where those prophecies were fulfilled throughout the New Testament. We can use our Bibles to increase our knowledge of Jesus, thus conquering fear and building our confidence in sharing the gospel. It's easy to share what you know, and it's hard to share what you don't know. We can use our Bibles to displace fear, not only in ourselves, but in people that need it. No matter what people's condition, we all need Jesus. We can share the gospel with the greatest and the least of these once we know and understand just what the gospel is. We should be able to spot some change in people if they've done more than just hear the gospel. If they've received it, it will change them. You know, there were many that were with Jesus that they got to be with Jesus. They got to hear sermons he preached. They got to see miracles he performed. And they still failed to believe. You know, it's written, "Blessed is those that will believe without the seeing." And we're here today because we've placed that hope in the belief of Jesus Christ. And it saddens me to know that I'm encouraging you to go share the gospel. And I know that even some of the people that you care about the most and that you're going to go share the most important thing about you with will not receive that message from you. But take heart, they heard it from Jesus himself and chose not to. And that's not an excuse for us to yield in sharing the gospel. It's not an excuse for us to be slow to. Because the fact is, many will not place their faith in Christ. But they can't even begin to unless they know the truths about him. They won't even have that chance unless somebody shares the story about the life, the death, and resurrection of Christ, and how that forgives our sin, how that allows us to be in relationship with God, allows us to spend an eternity with him. They won't know that unless we share that with them. You know, they may reject that. They may not receive that. But at that point, after you've shared it with them, that's really between them and God. And what was between you and God, you've done. Because if we think about the creator of the heavens and the universe, God spoke us into existence. Is there really anything that we can do for God? Is there anything that he needs from us that he can't himself provide? No, there's not. And so if he's asked us to do something, and that's the only thing that we can really do that would impress God or please him, I think it's upon us to do that. And that is simple in comparison to all that he does for us, his benevolent love for mankind, and his genuine personal love for each one of us that are in relationship with him. He gives us a small task in this world. You know, and there are a lot of things that we can get off of our plate, if you will, a lot of things that we want to avoid in life that are pleasing to him, that more so pleasing to our lives. They complement our lives. They make our lives easier to live, more blessed. But they keep us in right standing with God as well. I asked the question, do you think this made any difference in Nicodemus? And if you'll turn to me, with me, to John 19, verses 38 through 40. Take a drink and let you get there. The Gospel of John, chapter 19, verse 38 through 40, continues the story with Nicodemus. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. This is after his crucifixion. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, a man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. So talking about hearing the gospel and being able to see a difference in somebody, we can see where Jesus told Nicodemus about the significance of who he was and the importance of believing in him. And we can see here change in Nicodemus. I see fear replaced. He snuck to Jesus in the middle of the night, the first time we read about him. And here he's going to Jesus after he's been crucified, boldly, in my opinion. They've just killed Jesus. And to associate with him may, in fact, cause you to be crucified in the same way Jesus was. There is a lust for blood in the air, and so I feel like he's putting his life in jeopardy, but he's certainly not hiding the fact that he's caring for the body of Jesus. Him and Joseph take it down, and and embalm it with spices and linens. And so we can see how the hope he's placed in Jesus has replaced fear in his heart. We don't know the rest of the story of this man, yet I like to think he went on to continue to speak about Jesus and how he changed his life. So many times we see people and we wonder if they really are a believer. We wonder if they have put their hope in Christ. And that is truly between them and God. But I think it should be evident when we are saved that there are things we were saved from, that we can see change in people. Christ will change us. I liken it to somebody on the side of the road with a flat tire. If I came in here today late to preach and I said, well, I had a flat tire on the side of the road and a logging truck came along and ran over me and that's why I'm late. Most of you would say, well, Will, if a logging truck had hit you, we would be able to tell, you would be changed. And I think it's the same with God. God is much bigger than a logging truck. And if you've had an encounter with God, I suspect you should be changed. God will change us. And so we do hope to see change in people. More importantly, in ourselves. If we'll work on the change that we need to have in ourselves, we'll be focused with enough on our plate. So if we want to change the world that we live in, to make it a better place to live, to grow God's kingdom, we need to start with people, with sharing the gospel with them. If we'll each choose one person to share it with, we can start to make a real difference in this world. Because we can choose to just live in this world, or we can choose to make it a better place. And sometimes we try to make it a better place in so many different ways, with all of our efforts poured into politics, all of our efforts poured into our health. But if we will just start sharing the gospel with people, Christ will change this world, and Christ will make it a better place. And Christ will change the world that you live in, the people around you. We have that ability if we speak the truths of Christ. And if we will choose each one person to share that with, to make it our goal to witness to them, I have it in pretty good standing that the math is correct on this, that if we'll each choose one, we can double. We can double our kingdom for God. And so just like the shepherds on that first Christmas, we have the privilege to go and proclaim the birth of Messiah, about his life, his crucifixion, his resurrection, and our forgiveness. That's a really important part of our testimony, is to include how God has changed us, how he forgave us. That's what's going to speak the most to individuals. You know, I appreciate how often we've seen our pastor share the Evangie Cube and tell his personal story. I think that is the best thing we possess, is our personal stories. When we share that with people, it tends to speak to them. It's what matters the most to us, right? How God changed us and what he saved us from. So the knowledge of Christ is life-changing. it's world changing. And so as the worship team comes forward, I want to pray. And I want to ask you to bow your heads with me as I pray. And I want to ask the question, what is God saying to you? And how do you need to respond to Him? Maybe you need a church home. Maybe you need a baptism to get your baptism on the right side of salvation. Or maybe today you need to receive Christ. And do you need to know more about Jesus like Nicodemus did? Come pray with a deacon or one of us. God, thank you for your word. God, thank you that you love us. You love us in a mighty way. God, thank you that you showed humility, that you were born to a poor family. God, that you chose to walk the same hard life that we all walk. God, that you showed us that forgiveness was for all. It wasn't something you had to be able to afford. It wasn't something we had to be born into. God, that it was something that all could receive, from the greatest to the least of these. God, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
We know.
Tithe and offering boxes. You'll find one over there in the second pew, I think so, and one back here next to those doors. Don't forget to pray before you drop your offering in there. Ask God to bless it.
Spirituality becoming a wellness 12 Christian.
That is good stuff.
From 5 o'clock to about 7. So.
Yeah, please come join us for some discipleship tonight. Brian teaches a great class.
Okay. I don't know about that, but I'll.
Okay, no praise that enough.
Yes, thank you for joining us today. Please pray with me. God, thank you so much for the privilege to come to your house, to worship you, to learn about your truths, God, that your word could encourage us, could make us bold in sharing your gospel. God, please go ahead of us this week. Fight our battles for us. God, give us opportunities to tell people about Jesus this season. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.